I welcome one and all in today's function. We are honored to have with us today Mr. R. Venkataramani, the Attorney General of India. We will be soon joined by Dr. Birendra Saraf, the Advocate General of State of Maharashtra, as well as Mr. Vyas, the Additional Solicitor General. May I request our President, Mr. Nitin Thakkar, to welcome our honored guest, the learned Attorney General, in our midst and begin with today's function.
Sri R. Venkataramani, Attorney General of India. Mr. Vishal Kanade, Secretary, Bombay Bar Association. Senior advocates, members of the bar, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to learned Attorney General of India to the association who gave India its first Attorney General of India. Sir, we are the oldest bar association in the country. 9 members of our association have been the Chief Justices of India, including the present Chief Justice. 6 of our members have been Attorney Generals of India. Our bar has stood up against emergency by taking up several cases against the government of the day and inter alia challenged press censorship, challenged the order refusing permission to hold public meeting, which was addressed by Sri J.C. Shah and Sri Ram Jethmalani. We passed a resolution strongly supporting the stand that 42nd Amendment to the Constitution be abrogated and no citizen should be deprived of his legal rights by virtue of the said provisions. Our Attorney General needs no introduction. On 20th September 2022, he was appointed as Attorney General of India and he assumed office on 1st of October 2022. He has practiced in various branches of law, constitutional law, arbitration law, land laws, criminal laws, human rights law, consumer law, law relating to education, service law. He was member of Law Commission for 2 terms in 2010 and 2013. He was a member of Subcommittee on Directive Principles of State Policy, constituted by the Law Commission, reviewing working of the Constitution. He was co-opted member of the expert group constituted by the Ministry of Minority Affairs to examine and determine the structure and functions of Equal Opportunity Commission. He has authored a book on judgments of Justice O. Chinnappa Reddy. He has authored volume on torts in the Holsbury's Laws of India. He has published various articles on constitutional law, particularly concerning liberty, human rights, rule of law, legal education, and environmental law. He has also written a book on Supreme Court practice and procedure. The learned Attorney General has several international engagements to his credit. To name a few, he was invited to speak at the workshop jointly organized by the United Nations High Commissioner for Human Rights and International Commission of Jurists. He participated in the international meet engaged in drafting of an instrument on the right to food held at Berlin. He was invited to be involved in the Nepalese constitution drafting. He was involved in the work of International Commission of Jurists in Afro-Asian region. Therefore, we are thankful to you, sir, for having agreed to deliver a lecture on courts and democracies. So a very warm welcome to you again, sir. And a very warm welcome to the learned Advocate General of Maharashtra, Dr. Birendra Saraf. Our sincere thanks for attending this lecture by cancelling your other commitment. Thank you, sir. May I request our Secretary, Mr. Kanade, to present a plant and a token of our appreciation to the... We will also present a book, Legacy, which is a publication. May I request Kainas to present a bouquet to Advocate General. May I request Attorney General to address us?
The Attorney General must not look very serious. And he can't afford to be too on the lighter, you know, banter. And to address the bar of such eminent members, then I must be somewhat prepared, if not addressing a classroom. So when my very good friend Nitin asked me to address the Bombay Bar Association, and he kept asking me for a couple of days, then what subject would you like to talk? That was a challenging question, because we can pick up any subject, like go to any law school and start talking about it. And we have so many subjects on which you keep talking every day. Sometimes they're so tiresome. Because all of us know in our everyday engagement with court and law and our professional, personal career graph, there is always some issue or the other in law and justice which bothers us. And some of them are so challenging, we doesn't seem to be susceptible or open to any good solutions. And we still keep talking about it, like the arbitration law, we keep talking about it. And that's the beauty of talking. In the sense that there are some issues which are perennially challenging but perennially involving us. And I suppose that's how the profession is asked to be engaged in certain concerns. And while we are so engaged, I look at the vast diversity of our country. I've been a private practitioner of law for more than 42, 43 years. I never entered the portals of any government from close quarters, even though I appeared for a larger number of governments over a period of time. But that's like a temporary brush, you know, with governments and what they want to do. But an office like this, I found that within a fortnight of my taking over, an office like this, a certain other dimension which I never even perceived from a distance. So when somebody asked me that, how are you into this office now, I said, I'm trying to learn statecraft. So learning statecraft is very important for an office like this. I thought, let me share with you some of these lighter moments before I go into a heady subject on democracy and courts. So when Leonard Trent asked me about it, I said, I'll tell you a couple of days later. So for one of the recent constitution bench matters, I had lined up a large number of books on particularly the Kashmir issue and on constituent assembly, you know, referendum and so on and so forth. So one of the books lying on my table was about what constitutional courts in Asian countries are doing about becoming partners in democracy. So that thought came into my mind, and then I told him that night, I'll talk about courts and democracy. Pardon me, I picked up a very heavy subject for a Friday evening, but I thought that's one way of getting introduced to those of you who may be very seriously and definitely concerned about some of the fundamental issues and challenges in our country like any other country. I proceed on the footing that Indian democracy is a mature but not a dominating democracy. It is not a fragile democracy. And these distinctions are very important. I'll presently try to take you through some of the thoughts I've gathered on the subject. But as I was sharing my concerns in the afternoon, 2 o'clock, with the Western Bar Association, we have now matured through our managing both the constitution, our polity, and the court's engagement in dialogue with government. The way it has happened in India, perhaps it has not happened in different parts of the world. It has not happened even in the United States of America, with over 300 years of constitutional history. We still see the U.S. Supreme Court or academics in USA talking about the original intent versus a transformative constitution. We still see judges like Justice Scalia, who is no longer there, saying that the United States need not borrow from the rest of the world. But India has not been like that. Except for a short period, you know, in the initial days of a constitution working, we had many of those issues which came to Supreme Court under Article 301 and 304 about interstate trade and commerce. Supreme Court and High Court began to look at Australian, Canadian cases and virtually borrowed from the rich jurisprudence of those countries, because for more than 100 years, 7500 years, both Canada and Australia had a federal issue on trade and commerce. We borrowed from them. We did not have any difficulty in borrowing and looking at that. And we also have, for instance, looking back at America, one of the leading American academics called, he writes a book recently called Laws Partly Common to All Humankind. He goes back to the Roman period when trade in Rome happened from almost all over Asia and good part of southern Europe. So people congregating in Europe, how do you really manage their trade disputes? So Rome tried to put together the local tradition, the local rule, the local norms, which traders carried with themselves, and put them together as something lost partly common to all humankind. I think that's a grand idea. And at a point of time when there was no globalization of the nature we have today, when there's no United Nations we have today, but still people borrowed, and borrowed in good measure. So why I'm talking about this borrowing has now acquired a different dimension. It is not merely a legal borrowing in isolation. It is not merely picking up some doctrines and principles in isolation without getting connected to the global social, political, and economic situation. So it's a different kind of a borrowing which is happening and which is bound to happen. And I'm sure we should, the legal fraternity in India, I think in due course of time, would probably visualize a different kind of a borrowing. And connected with that, in the, one of the recent conferences in Ancitral, I thought India is time that, of course, we are trying to pack ourselves back on our saying that India is a leading trade and commerce partner in the world, and G20, so on and so forth, being showcased. It's time that the Indian experiment and the Indian contribution to jurisprudence is begins to be noticed, not from sporadic borrowings and quoted in some UK Supreme Court judgment or South African Constitutional Court, or you will find our basic structure brought in virtually being borrowed in several parts, you know, applied in several parts of the world. They're all very sporadic, sometimes in isolation, sometimes in a context which may require a borrowing. But I'm looking at the role of India in a broader sense. And that broader sense is where I think the legal fraternity of India would be in a position to contribute hugely. We have, it's not that on a lighter vein or in a narrow, you know, patriotic way, I say that the Indian bar is no less than the rest of the world. We do have talents which are not recognized elsewhere. We do have talents across, you know, the diverse sections of a community in the bar. So we need to do something very radically, fundamentally changing about the contours of a profession, the way we can manage the legal fraternity, the engagement in the affairs of our community. It's in that sense I thought I may try to engage on this, what I call the heady subject of courts and democracies, having made this little long, you know, introduction. And let me try to read what I, in fact, I would have loved to speak extempore, but there are few thoughts and ideas which require picking up, you know, extract some articles, some books, and things like that. Therefore, and then keeping in mind that I am addressing a very enlightened bar, and Bombay with all his contribution to the jurisprudence of our country, not only in Bombay, but in the capital of India. I thought, let me be a little more, careful enough in articulating my thoughts and putting them in a way that they are, if not hugely received, I mean reasonably received. So with that fond hope, I put in a few thoughts in my few pages, and then let me try to slowly read them, unless I cross the time which has been set for today's evening. Thank you so much for all that. And one more thought which disturbs me, I mean, after I took over this appointment, what was challenging was looking at the entire landscape of the Indian, the performance of courts in India and the performance of the legal fraternity in India. And that took me on an engaging exercise of analyzing, evaluating what are we doing today and what can be done tomorrow. Like knowing the demands of today and the needs of the future. So we have current demands and the needs of the future, they're both connected. So when you analyze both of them, I think we are on a path where we can probably comfort ourselves and solace ourselves saying that we are part of a social affairs and contributors. And finally, before I start reading, when you look at the contributions of lawyers and judges and how a genre of literature is written in the United States or in UK, there are a huge volume of literature written about the contributions of lawyers and judges and how it has probably virtually transformed the landscape of jurisprudence in USA or UK. We do not have enough of that literature here. Many of us humble in our own engagement in the profession, but great enough in our contributions. We do not know how to measure what we say every day in the court becomes part of what is the law of our country. Therefore, the connection between what we say and what we think and what we want the court to do and getting translated into the law of the land is a very important link. And I wish that more and more of this contribution by lawyers becoming part of the law of a country is written more and more in order that the future generation knows who came and did what, for what purposes, and how it became part of our legal traditions. It's very important. Like Holmes writing as common law long ago. And all of us have been taught in the British School of Jurisprudence that common law is a great gift which the colonial country has given to us. But I was beginning to talk about the common law of Indian jurisprudence, the common law of constitutional jurisprudence in India, and what meaning does it make? These are stray thoughts I thought we must keep talking about, thinking about, and beyond, of course, in our everyday professional concerns and engagement. We have other issues, and of course we are bogged down by that some of the times, but I wish that the big part and the most significant part of the administration of law and justice in our country, we may have to take an extra mile to see in what way we can sooner or later transform the justice landscape of our country. Now let me start talking about this. Superior courts and democracies are now two hugely debated institutions and ideas. Any historical treatise on democracy would love to go back to the Athenian democracy and Plato's dialogues. Socially, politically, and institutionally, we have moved far, far away from the days of the Greek. John Locke told us that the authority of all governments did not lay in divine right but in their ability to protect the rights of citizens. He argued that, I quote, no government can have a right to obedience from a people who have not freely consented to it. I quote, this idea of the consent is not merely a matter of electoral choice, but something which may be said to run to the whole idea of the Constitution and the expression and demonstration of consent through rule of law. Francis Fukuyama, in his The End of History and the Last Man, thought that the liberal democracy as conceived and practiced in the West is the end of history. No further evolution of institutions and political processes beyond liberal democracy can be visualized according to him. But however, he soon realized that the whole idea of liberal democracy at the end of history needs to be revisited. You will find in recent times both academic scholars and people in public life, like Thomas Piketty in France or Bernie Sanders, a long-standing senator in USA, then beginning to talk about the continuing challenges of social and economic inequality and the perceived failures of free market economy. These are deep reflections on looking at democracy, its promises and its lapses. I do not propose to get deeper into this heady subject on an evening like this. As practitioners of law, we of course cannot close our eyes to the connection between law and democracy and the practice of law impacting democracy and vice versa. I propose to quickly look at engagement of constitutional and superior courts in their democratic functioning and unraveling the dimensions of what Locke called the free consent of the people. Alexander Hamilton in Federalist 78 famously declared that the judicial branch would be the least dangerous of the three branches of democracy, reasoning that it has no influence over either the sword or the purse, no direction either the strength or the wealth of the society. We have begun to, however, see that the judicial branch now commands influence over both the purse and the sword. We have the Rafale case and the strength and the wealth of the society. We see the court interventions in right to health, the Hindenburg report, the interventions in mineral resources auction, etc. Wide range of them. John Jay was the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States in 1789. And he resigned as Chief Justice in 1795 after being elected as Governor of New York. When he was offered a Chief Justice again in 1900, he turned it down by telling the President that the court lacked the energy, the weight, and the dignity. If John Jay were to be offered his position to the Supreme Court of India today, he would have welcomed his offer, and he would not have called the court lacking in energy, weight, and dignity. In his introduction to the 2021 publication of the Proceedings of International Academic Conference of the Colombian Constitutional Court, the Associate Justice of the Court, Alejandro Cantillo, remarks, I quote, "Constitutional courts today are today in the spotlight of legal, political, and social battles." In 1977, when Raoul Berger published his controversial book, Government by Judiciary, Allegations of Judiciary, dealing with what the U.S. Supreme Court has done with the 14th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, he wrote, I quote, "The present generation, floating on a cloud of post-Warren Court euphoria, applauds a court which read its libertarian convictions in the 14th Amendment, forgetting that for generations the court was harshly criticized because it had transformed laissez-faire into a constitutional dogma in order to halt the spread of socialism." With Brahmin restraint, Justice Holmes commented, In fear of socialism, new principles have been discovered outside the bodies of those instruments, constitutions, which will be generalized into acceptance of the economic doctrines which prevailed about 50 years ago," unquote. The logic whereby the process becomes sanctified when employed for libertarian ideas has yet to be spelled out. Logic, it is true, must yield to history, but history affords the court even less support than logic. A 2017 commentary on Asian Superior Court says this, quote, "In the past century, as the winds of political change swept across the globe, Asian nations too experienced a wave of democratization as countries in the region gained independence or transitioned from authoritarian military rule toward more participatory politics. In tandem with this democratization trend, we also witnessed a concomitant expansion of judicial power in Asia, whereby new courts are empowered. Old ones emerge as independent constraints on governmental authority. The rise of the courts and the accompanying judicialization of politics is as much an Asian phenomenon as it is a prevalent trend in the West. There is now a rich corpus of literature on how Asian courts have participated in and even reshaped the human rights dialogues and discourse in their respective jurisdictions. However, little academic literature has examined how Asian judiciaries have responded to deficiencies in the electoral processes and the concomitant problems of partisan self-dealing, specifically partisan self-dealing occurs when the political actors devise electoral rules that govern voting, political parties, electoral boundaries, apportionment, the administration of elections, and campaign finance that are designed to entrench themselves in power, end quote. Reshaping or shaping our rights discourse beyond legislative assemblies is what is happening. Constitutions are no longer clean slates, or the tabula rasa, they call it. The court's overwritings and eager scribbling, if I put it like that, on what every aspect of constitution means virtually narrates both democracy and the blurring of institutional lines. The expansion of judicial power is now a global phenomenon. Some simplistic comments and offered in justification of apex courts as best suited to limit populist impulses of party politics and executive failure in their everyday governance. Governance failures and wrongs, from not attending to stray dog menace in urban areas to protection of rare bat species in Rajasthan deserts, from regulating firecrackers during Diwali to asking service of court summons on women at home as doing gender justice, warrant, as many radical Democrats say, would say, that the courts are the real democratic institutions. What Justice Krishnaya called a third world remedial jurisprudence has now become basic structural jurisprudence. Before I dwell into the contemporary judicial journeys, let me pick up some threads about democracy. Joseph Schumpeter, an Asian economist, said, quote, whatever else be important about democracy, its core is acquiring the power to decide by means of competitive struggle for the people's vote. Competitive struggle for the people's vote. Let us look at what it means, the power to decide and connect it with the free consent of the people, as we saw earlier. The mediating element between the power to decide and free consent, I understand, is the Constitution. The free consent pervading the Constitution, namely the will of the people, must make sense in the midst of political parties, powerful corporate bodies, religious associations, trade unions, regulatory bodies, including central banks deciding monetary policies, constitutional commissions, media, including social media, and the digital world. So democracy is governed by the Constitution, except where it is governed by other frameworks such as people's democracy as in China. But Constitution has to be protected by democracy. Is that a paradox? Democracy without constraining public and private power can be chaotic and even polarizing, given the diversity of our country. Majority rule without checks can be problematic. Who can be suitable managers of this complex phenomenon? And who can design and devise checks while being accountable and in receipt of people's acknowledgement? We often talk about the veto power of the people pressed through electoral processes, courtesy Supreme Court insisting on right to expression, as including right to know about the criminal antecedents of candidates. This veto power is getting more realistic. An interesting and instructive example is what happened after the 2010 Belgian election. The conservative New Flemish Alliance got about 17.4% of the vote. The Socialist Party and five other parties did not muster any majority for over 200 days. The king tried all his best to gather a coalition. And a year and a half after the election, a government was formed. Since all the parties were similarly sized, and none of them fitted as a coalition partner, and thus that all had a veto, and that Belgian had to wait for 200 days to form a democratic government. Now one shudders to think about even a near parallel situation in India, even though it may never happen here, only because our constitutional system is mediated by courts. Let me quickly take you through other examples of courts managing or administering democracy. We may look at what has been described as dynamic democracy. The Constitutional Court of Korea, by a series of interventions, particularly in the party organizations, or right to stand for elections, and where the court struck down as unconstitutional the law which required independent candidates to deposit a huge amount as candidates for eligibility, or a law which, or where the court talked about the issue as one of social classes and generations, and affecting people of ordinary means and younger generations from contesting elections. The court invalidated a law that only permitted election of candidates and their staff to participate in electoral campaigns. The court struck down a blanket prohibition on the participation of journalists in electoral campaigns. The court also deemed unconstitutional a complete ban on political parties receiving donations from the public. The court again intervened on an electoral law that imposed a ban on all election campaigns before the commencement of the designated campaign period. It is said that the party system in Korea, with a multitude of splits, mergers, and reconfigurations, having reasonably matured, is a product of the Constitutional Court's intervention. One can see a near similar intervention by the Constitutional Court of Taiwan, which began with its ban on indefinite exercise of powers by the first-term legislator. Interestingly, in the context of allegations of misappropriation of public funds by the president and his wife, and the claim made by the president that he was immune from criminal prosecution, the Constitutional Court in 2007 ruled against the arguments of the president, and that the immunity also extended to his first lady, and the court held that the immunity did not foreclose any investigation to collect evidence that may be used against him after the term of the office ended. A very innovative idea. Turning our attention to what has been described as dominant party democracies such as Malaysia and Hong Kong, we can notice that the Hong Kong court has achieved modest results in the domain of electoral representation. The reason is not far to seek. Even while deliberating, prisoners' voting rights or convicted prisoners' right to stand for election, or the peculiar system of corporate entities' right to vote, what is known as the functional constituency's electoral method in Hong Kong, the Court of Final Appeal, Hong Kong has been seen as a very moderate. The Standing Committee of the National People's Congress of China is empowered to overrule any constitutional decision of the Court of Final Appeal by a legislative intervention. A near similar story seems to be happening with the Malaysian court, who seem to have done little to countermand the long-standing hegemonic Barisan Nasional political coalition in a minor but important challenge that the method of identification of voter could be manipulated. The Court of Appeal in Malaysia held that judicial review alone action is inappropriate. In 2015, the High Court of Malaysia did not persuade itself to nullify a general election which was challenged on the basis of the Prime Minister's US $681 million transfer donation scandal. A dominant party dwarfs and marginalizes the courts, as can be seen from the above illustrations. Within 1932, when Thailand became a constitutional monarchy, and April 2017, it has seen 19 constitutions, and the 1997 People's Constitution for the first time created a constitutional court. It's a matter of record that since 2006, the Constitutional Court has nullified two general elections, it's removed three prime ministers, and dissolved six political parties. It is said that the Constitutional Court has actively perpetuated Thailand's democratic rollback by rendering constitutional safeguards ineffectual and ephemeral. Bangladesh also has been so far fallen in the class of present these kind of democracies. While the court has stood its ground in matters relating to the independence of judiciary, it could not intervene against martial law regimes and the four states of emergency. Though in recent times, a resurgence is thought to be established, with neither purse nor the sword, the authority of the Bangladesh Supreme Court to enhance democratic values is yet to be seen. The stories in South American continent, particularly that of the Colombian Constitutional Court, offers a different narration. The Colombian Constitutional Court has been hailed as one of the most powerful courts of the global South. Its forays into civil, political, and economic rights issues are perceived to be closer to the Indian constitutional history post-emergency. On the same wavelength, one can notice the movement of the Indonesian Constitutional Court, invoking the rule of law principle as a foundation for reviewing constitutionality of statutes. Such instances range from challenge to the advocate's law or the retrospectivity of a new terrorism law, or again holding the due process as a component of a rule of law when it intervened against an election law prohibiting persons belonging to certain banned organizations from contesting elections. The Indonesian term for rule of law is the concept of negara hukum, which is claimed to be distinct from the Western concept of rule of law. Both democracy and courts work by interpretive tools. Both engage in clarifying and creative interpretations. For democracy to be vibrant and fulfilling its demands and obligations, it needs to constantly interpret. Interpret information, interpret its functions from the point of view of delivery, interpret its performance vis-à-vis its promises and arrangements, and this can be what we call a clarifying interpretation, clarifying to both the citizens and to itself. It also needs to interpret social needs, interpret its legal products to orderly manage social matters. It must provide for justice, for punishment, for laying rules, for regulation of all affairs of the community. These interpretive tasks need to be and must be creative. A mechanical, callous, inattentive, or uninvolved reading of its task will lead to stagnation or productive unrest, silent initially, but explosive in due course. The Arab Spring instances or the recent protests in parts of a neighbor are these instances. This creative interpretation by democracy managers we call the social and reality interpretation. This interpretation keeps the social compact meaningful and enables democracy escape its demise or even occasional collapses. Courts engage also in two levels of interpretations. One, primarily where only the text of the law is clarified. This clarifying job merely involves laying bare the meanings that can be gathered, like picking up fallen leaves and fruits without effort. The other exercise is creative. This is more demanding. It involves both objective and subjective reading of the legal text. This reading involves digging the soil of everything relating to the legal text, all socially connecting, historically embedded meanings will be harvested. This is akin both to a mathematician's job of discovery of equations and also the artist's job of sculpting a stone into a figure, or like the weaver turning out an embroidered cloth. The tools and aims of the job on a close examination will be seen fundamentally the same as what managers of democracy are called upon to do. This field has been the most argued field of US constitutional law, the originalist versus the living tree adherents. We have begun to coin new expressions such as constitutional morality or transformative constitution to justify court occupation of primary or even core areas of democracy management. Let me explain. What democracy managers and judges need to first encounter reality, and reality is never constant. Both of them need to grapple with discovering the best tools of understanding and doing justice. Both must know which principle or norm will be suitable for a task or a result. Both must know how to avoid the thistles and thorns in walking bushy terrains. This comparison is necessary for a better understanding of the organic connection between the interpretive tasks of both institutions. That both are differently called upon to do democracy management, in other words, democracy management is now constitutionally distributed with the respective interpretive tasks but going different. When the democracy managers fail in either of the interpretive tasks or distort them, the court's interpretive task becomes not only onerous but can be problematic. We see that courts begin to enter into the shoes of the democracy managers, sometimes by compulsion and sometimes by volition. The voluntary entry of courts into substitute interpretive role can rob democracy of its vitality. The many politically based matters now enter the contest through law. The contest then enters a court-ruled contest. Often, many defects of governance call for some accountability command, like the recent hospital deaths matter, or the Joshima town sinking matter, or matters which arose during COVID. From the Husainara cartoon to the Kataria, the deep disappointments of ordinary non-policy governance, the court has been drawn into democracy interpretation. As we noticed earlier, with reference to the few Asian countries, the court becomes either a weak partner or a leading partner in democracy management. Madbury versus Madison was only the first letter of the democracy management alphabet. The question has, however, become very acute. Democracy management itself has become a complex and onerous job. Globalization of varied dimensions and aspects, accompanied by life-changing technologies, now demand not mere domestic attention, but global interpretations. This exposes democracy to the task of more and more of creative interpretations. It appears that this task demands engagement of multitude of multiple managers of democracy, and that cannot be done without rewriting Montesquieu. We are asked to have more fundamental rules and democracy management distribution. This task is at the bar, and perhaps we need a constituent assembly of the Indian bar to delve deep into this matter. So that's, I think, a subject which keeps engaging me. I suppose this idea of a constituent bar or the assembly of the Indian bar is a very important and a demanding task before the legal fraternity. And I just shared a few stray thoughts about how constitutional courts across the globe have either become weak partners or active partners or changing partners of democracy. Now, one fundamental thought, and I'll share it with you and try to close my today's discussion with you. And those of us who have studied political philosophy, and a dominant political philosophy which began to engage the 18th and 19th century in Europe and most of the globe, namely the communist or the socialist political philosophy. And one of the great exhortations in the Communist Manifesto by Marx was that philosophers have only hitherto interpreted the world, but the point, however, is to change it. So those who wanted to change the world became the managers of changing the world. So we know how by 100 years, or more than 70 to 100 years of the socialist experiment, this changing the world is an important issue. Who changes the world, according to what norms, on what rules, and according to the consent of the people? Therefore, the changing the world is what is to be probably looked at very closely. All of us would like to have the world change. We want to talk about reforms in religion, talk about reform in our personal social equations, gender justice. Yes, we want to change. Change must come. But then who will change? On what participatory basis? And how will changes come? Therefore, I understand the consent of the people John Locke talked about is at the core of democracy. And if we understand that rule of law is a non-violent revolution, I think more and more become closer to a non-violent aspect of rule of law as a revolution which can make consent of the people more and more participatory and less divisive. So the very huge challenges, but I suppose given the genius of our country, the genius of all the talents of men and women with all accomplishments and scholarship and the mature wisdom we have, I'm sure in due course of time, sooner or later, my appeal to the legal fraternity that we need to have a constituent assembly of the Indian bar probably should roll into your mind and see how it takes shape. I know we can probably become the most important advisors. I understand that while you walk into the court arguing a PIL or very challenging, attractive cases, we want to become part of history. I think I'm not looking at that. It happens. But I think I'm looking at something beyond that. As collective partners in the managers, I think we must go a little beyond our current engagement in law and democracy. And I wanted to take this very attractive opportunity given by Mr. Nitin to talk to you and share, if I may call, if I am not mistaken, my naive, if not infantile thoughts, my naive thoughts on we can look at law, justice, democracy, courts from very, very different angles and understanding. And I'm extremely thankful for this evening's opportunity. I thank each and every one of you. Many of you may know so closely. And I'm thankful to you for being here. And I'm sure that we'll keep carrying forward this dialogue in more than one way. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. I would like to sincerely thank Mr. R. Venkataramani, the Attorney General of India, for having accepted our invitation and for giving such an erudite talk on today's subject. I would also like to thank Mr. Devang, Vyas, the Additional Solicitor General, for having joined us. May I request our member, Ms. Savita Sadananda, to kindly present to him a token of our affection and our book, which is called Legacy of Law. Also like to sincerely thank Dr. Birendra Saraf for being here with us and for gracing this occasion. Lastly, I would like to thank all our members for being present here in such large numbers. This concludes our function. Please join us for tea and snacks.